Hi. Actually, a box has just appeared on my screen, so I'm just gonna get rid of that, and hopefully you can all hear me. Thanks for coming along to the workshop. It's the first time we did it. It was really enjoyable, and everyone got involved, and it was I think something new for everyone, including myself, because I've only done this process a few times. And every time we get involved in a workshop, it's always has different results. And so the great thing about this is there's no right or wrong way to make Gyotaku printing. But first, I'll just give you a little outline about what it is. As you can see, we've got some materials here. We've got some ink. We've got some rice paper. The ink you can get on online. Or in a delicatessen. I got this in a kind of delicatessen or a fishmonger, and that's cuttlefish ink. You can use Squid's ink. It's quite freely available, or you can just use acrylic paint, or you can use Chinese ink. I've got some Chinese paper here, some rice paper, and I've also got a brush, a roller, and a spoon. So just to give you a little bit of background, Gyotaku printing developed around the 18th century in Japan, and it was a way of fishermen being able to record their catch. And so it's a famous one that got away. It was a way of proving to your friends and relatives that you'd caught a big fish. So it's one of the lovely ways that an art form came out of a way of people proving the size of the fish that they caught. And gyo means fish, and taku means impression. So it just means fish printing. And it's a really direct way of getting some incredibly interesting results. Now, the first thing that we need to do is to get some ink on the fish. And the way I'm going to do that here is to use the Squid's ink. So I'm just going to put a few spoonfuls of this into my paint bucket, paint kettle. I'm going to add a little water. Now, you'll find that you might want to change the amount of water or change the consistency of the paint a few times. It doesn't really matter because we're all in a learning curve here. So you can get it quite thin. I would say about this, the consistency of a kind of single cream. Mix it up, and then I'm just going to pour it into this trough.
So,
That's a bit, sorry, go ahead.
we've actually got a question from one of our participants.
Yeah.
And they've said, I've gone for the fennel option. Should I just follow along in the same way?
For the what option, sorry?
Fennel.
Fennel. Oh, meaning you using a piece of vegetables
Yeah.
instead of using. Yeah, absolutely. So this is the same process. It's just direct printing. I'm using fish because it's the original way that this art form was developed. But when we did the workshop originally, I used broccoli and cauliflower. You can use anything. It's just a way of direct printing. And in fact, there's another kind of printing that the word taku comes from. Sorry, I keep getting a box coming up on my iPad that I have to turn off. And there's a way of stone printing, which is the same thing, where you wet a piece of rice paper and put it onto like a gravestone or a piece of stone architecture, and then you can take a kind of rubbing, a bit like brass rubbing, but you use ink in a little pad to take the impression. So you can use it on stone, on paving stones, on manhole covers. You can use it on vegetables. You can do it on your own hand if you wish to. You can really experiment. I'm just using a fish because the original art form comes from gyo, meaning fish, and taku, meaning impression or stone impression. So go ahead, use anything you want. I understand some people get a little bit squeamish about using fish, but when we did the first workshop, it was so much fun. Most people at first were a bit, this is a bit gross, but by the end of it, everyone was really enjoying the process. But what I'm gonna do now is I'm just gonna use the brush, I think, this time, but you can use the roller as well to get some ink onto the fish. Now, I washed this fish. It's not 100% necessary. I gave it a little wash just to get rid of some of the slimy stuff that was on it. But actually, I don't know. I think maybe the slime might be helpful. And I'm just applying a kind of generous amount of ink to the fish. Now, what I will say is that the first one usually comes out a little bit dark, but I'm going to make the impression with this, just to show you the kinds of results you're likely to get from the first imprint. And it will be quite dark. And I'm going to use, first of all, a piece of Chinese rice paper.
Steve, we've had another question come through from one of our
participants.
Can we eat the fish afterwards?
Yes. That's the great thing about this. If you just wash off the ink, especially if it's cuttlefish or Chinese ink, but even with acrylic paint, as long as you wash it off before it dries, you can eat it. And most of the time, one would skin the fish anyway. So if you're worried about it being black, you could just get rid of the skin. But yes, absolutely, I plan to eat this later on. And last time we did the workshop, we had a big feast afterwards, and it was really enjoyable to have made art out of it and not waste it, because that would be a little bit sad, I think. So once you've got the paper onto the fish, just take a little bit of time to gently massage the fish. Not so hard that you break the paper, but just so you know that all of the spines and the fins have been covered, just like here on the end. I'm going to make sure that I can really get my fingers into that. And the other thing is it, you know, talking about whether we can eat it or not, it really reminds me of cooking. So it's similar to preparing something that you're going to cook, only we're going to get an artwork out of it and then cook it. So it's a cross between being Rick Stein and an art program, I think. Take heart, for those of you who remember that. All right, now I'm going to remove it and see what we've got. Okay. So as you can see, that first impression is quite dark. And I was expecting that because that's what happens. So don't worry if your first impression is quite dark. That can also just help to get, even though you can see some nice details here in the fin and some of the eye, that just helps to get some of the excess ink off. Now I'm using a sea bream. I've also got some little I've got some little lemon soles and some sardines as well, because I'll try something with them a little bit later. But I'm now just going to try a piece of brown paper.
Steve,
see how that comes out. Yeah.
If you aren't able to get hold of rice paper or a washi paper, is it possible to use other types of paper, perhaps?
Yes, exactly. I'm just about to do an example of that. This is just regular brown paper. So I thought I'd do an impression with this just to see how this comes out. Slightly thicker and maybe a little bit more absorbent. And just so you can show sort of how universal this technique is, I'm going to see what happens with this. Now, the whole thing about this process is it's trial and error. Don't expect to get really great results straight away. We've got 45 minutes. You can play with the consistency of the ink. You can roll it with a roller while it's in with the paper on it. This helps as well sometimes, you know, just to get the detail. Or you can just use your hands. And traditionally, the artist would leave the eye. You wouldn't put the ink over the eye and then they'd paint the eye in later. But I just like to do the whole thing. And if you're doing a piece of fennel bulb or something like that, that can give you similar results. Now there it is on the brown paper, and as you can see, we're taking ink off again, and I think that actually works pretty well. Now if you're happy with that, go ahead, but I've got a good feeling that the next impression that we get is going to be the one, because as you can see, there's already some sort of highlighting here. This is very much like doing a rubbing, if you've ever done any brass rubbing or something like that, but with ink. So I'm just going to try and make sure that we've got a good coating of ink, not too thick, not too thin, and then massage it in. And with this washi or rice paper, sometimes made of rice, sometimes made of mulberry leaves, you can see through and kind of see what you're doing a little bit more, which can be helpful. But really, it doesn't matter. You can use newsprint, that's good. You just don't want it to be too thick. Alternatively, what you can do is ink up the fish and then place it directly onto the paper and press it from behind. There's nothing to say we have to do it like this, and we'll try one of those in a minute as well. Now, let's see if that's a good one. Now, I think that's pretty good. Can you see that? That's a pretty fishy print there. And you get a lot of the detail. But I think as we go along, we're going to become more and more adept at making a more realistic print. And some of these prints, you'd be surprised, they look like photographs. Some of the people in the workshop were making much, much more impressive prints than I was able to make. I'm just going to try with a little bit of the ink on a roller.
So Steve, you've been actually using this technique within your work for quite a while now. Could you talk to us a bit about kind of what it is that you love about the process, why you're so intrigued by this particular technique?
For me, it's the directness. There's other kinds of printing directly, like mono printing, but it means that you can get a direct impression of a real thing. And in my work, I've been very involved with ideas about materiality and making an image of something by making an impression by doing a drawing, for instance, or making an image of a thing that's incredibly lifelike and direct. And by doing this, it seems to me that you can kind of get both. So you're getting a lifelike impression, but something that's made direct contact with the subject, with the materiality of the thing we're looking at. I'm just going to lift up the spine there and get in there and see if we can get all of those things. So yes, my work's very much about trying to see the different lines between making a drawing or making something that's much more true to life in terms of direct application. But also to answer your question, I haven't done it a lot. It's a process that I'm really interested in and have been. But for ages, I was too scared to do it. And until you actually get your hands dirty and get involved, you don't realize how much fun it is. And that's the most important thing for me of this, is it's really enjoyable. And there's another form of Japanese crafts and art that I'm interested in, and it's a way of making pottery which has the name raku, which means enjoyment. And so this has a lot of raku in it, a lot of enjoyment. Gyotaku raku. Okay, there's another example, and I think this is a pretty good impression. You can see the scales there, and it kind of worked a little bit better with the roller than using the brush. And depending on the paper and the amount you put on, you'll find that you get really differing techniques.
Yeah, we absolutely can't wait to see everyone's uploaded images to our gallery on our website of what you've been creating today. We just want to let us know where you're joining us from today. We've got a lot of participants that are signed in. We've got someone in Detroit, Michigan. Hello to you. And also hi to Sumi in Redhill in Surrey. So please drop in the Q&A. Where is it that you're joining us from?
Okay. So this is kind of, you know, I feel like this is a kind of relaxation technique. You know, there's nothing precious about it at all. Every time I do one, it's different. Sometimes I'm disappointed, sometimes I'm happy, but I think that's a pretty good one. And you can really see the eye there and you can see the fin. And in Japan, there are several ways of doing this. Traditionally, one would be to later add color, add a little color and then fill in the eye. Other ways of doing it, like I said before, is to wet the rice paper and apply it to the fish and then use a kind of sponge to make an impression over the paper. And we can try that here by using just a little ink on the roller, not too much. In fact, I'm going to just try and get a lot of that off on the side here. And then just running that over the fish as well. You can see that that's taking some impression.
It's quite a relaxing technique.
Yeah, it's very relaxing
process. It's really wonderful. Just want to say hello to everyone joining us. Thanks for letting us know where you're checking in from today. We've got Teresa in Sheffield. Hello. Jack at Farnham Road Hospital in Guildford. Sarah in sunny Derbyshire. Oh, I wish it was sunny here in London where we are. And hello to Holly at the JBU ward in Maudsley. Hello to Suzanne from Exeter in Devon. And hello to Robert. So thank you so much again for joining us for today for Steve's wonderful workshop.
Here's another way of making the image. You can actually apply the ink either by a roller or by rubbing it with a piece of charcoal. Or a pencil even, I think, a soft enough pencil or a similar kind of material. And then you can make a rubbing through the paper, if it's thin enough, of the fish. Now, clearly that's quite a different result, but it's not a million miles away. What I'm gonna try and do now is ink the fish up and then apply it directly to the paper. So rather than pressing the paper over it, I'm gonna push the fish down onto it. Now, there's other ways of doing it. If you wanted to make this fin show up, you could find some way of putting that down. Traditionally, they would use sort of pins to hold that out. But I think it's enough to be handling this material and working with the fish and making it a very natural process. There's something very rewarding about it, especially knowing that you can have a delicious meal later on. Now I'm gonna apply this. And again, I'll make one impression. I assume then that the ink will be a little bit thick. And then I'll do another one. So on this occasion, I'm just gonna push the fish down onto the paper. Last time we had a big squid. And I was concerned that the squid might be a little bit too blobby and difficult to make a print form, but it worked incredibly well. That was really, really successful. I couldn't get a squid this time because I thought it would be appropriate if you can use squid's ink and use a squid. You can just lift it up and check what you're doing. Make sure that it's been nicely pressed onto the paper. And then in a second, I'm just going to pull this up and see what we've got. Even you can just sort of pull the paper up around it like that.
It's also nice that you're kind of getting your fingerprints in there as well, Steve. That's really becoming part of the artwork itself.
I think so. And for me, that's part of the signature. You know, in Japan, you'd have a little ink stamp that you would sign it with. But I always find that the participants in the workshops or myself have left their signature anyway by putting their thumbprints over it. So that's very well pressed down. And let's see what happens when I pull that off. So again, I think that's pretty successful. I haven't got the face done particularly well, but it they're always different. You'll never get the same result twice. And that is what's part of the joy of the process. So I'm just going to put that down, and then I'm going to try with some of the brown paper.
Got lots more people joining us today, Steve. We've got Rachel in Johnson PQ and Ladywell. The patients are really enjoying the session. Thank you so much for joining us today. Greetings from students in Scarborough in North Yorkshire. Hello to you. And please keep letting us know where you are today in the Q&A.
Now this one, I'm going to do a mixture of both. So I'm going to push it down onto the paper. I'm going to flip it over. Rub it as well, because depending, like I said earlier, on the paper, kind of ink you're using, the thickness of the ink, it's always going to be different. And so there's no right or way or wrong way to do this. That is a big mess, but it's quite a nice mess. I think you can see that there that we're getting some nice results from the
wonderful
from the scales.
Yeah, really lovely.
And sometimes the uglier the fish, the better. I think last time I used some John Dory and they had big bony, they call them bony faced fish. And they were really useful. So what I'll do now is I'll put this one to one side and get some different fish out. Doesn't matter if you're making a mess. I mean, that's the whole nature of it. Why don't we try it with just this humble little sardine? See what happens.
Is there a fish that you'd absolutely love to kind of work with or try this technique with one day that you might not necessarily be able to get your hands on?
Yeah.
Imagine this with kind of an octopus or something fantastical like that.
You can get octopus fairly easily, I think, but the flat, sometimes it's good with something nice and flat and with lots of texture. There is a fish called the sunfish, which is huge. I wouldn't like to use them because I think they're fairly endangered, but they would be amazing to see a print of it. But like I said, originally with this process, you were able to catch the fish and then throw it back. So that would be nice to be able to do it for me, to be able to go on a trawler and maybe do it so that the fish could carry on living its life, maybe with just a little squid's ink on it for 2 or 3 seconds of its life. So that'd be fun to do it with a live fish and then throw it back. But I think what's nice is just to use anything. I mean, I'd like to try it. You could try it. There's artists who printed their own bodies in a similar way. An artist called Franz Klein. And he would either use himself or models, and they would paint themselves in this special blue called Franz Klein blue, and then apply themselves to the paper and dance around on it or make their own impressions in that way.
Wonderful. Would you be able to hold that one up for us, Steve?
Yeah, so there's a little sardine.
Brilliant. We've also got Hannah joining us from Greenfields today. If you'd like to say hello, Steve.
Hello. It's Greenfields is where I originally did the first workshop, and I was so nervous because I didn't know if anyone would enjoy it, but we had such a great time doing it that it's given me a lot of satisfaction knowing that people were able to enjoy it. I also did it with a massive workshop that took place at Tate St. Ives, and that was actually carried out without me, more or less. I started it, but latterly it became this really exciting project with lots and lots and lots of school children getting involved, and they enjoyed that. I'm going to get another fish out. I'm going to go for it.
And for those of us today that are joining in with vegetables, Steve, do you have any tips or any ways in which that might be kind of a different technique, different methods?
Yes, you can. There's things you can do with vegetables which I tried out before. You, rather than using, let's say, the whole of a floret of cauliflower or broccoli, you can cut it in half or have it cut in half for you. And then you can use that as a stamp, much in the way that one would do a sort of potato print. And that has really good results. One of the things that I did when I was at Greenfields was to get masking tape, and I put sort of horizontal lines of masking tape, and the first one I did was diagonal lines of masking tape, and then make the impression with the vegetables, and then pull the masking tape off, and it had the very organic shape of the vegetables, and the very formal or rigid shape of the masking tape, which made a kind of a very hard edge pattern next to something very soft and organic, which was really successful. And we had a lot of examples of that. I don't know if they're available online to see the results of the Greenfield Greenfield project, but it was really good fun. And now I don't know how this is going to come out, so I'm just going to lay this over both the fish, give it a rub, and see if these two things can swim along in the ocean next to each other, both going in the same direction. Now, the thing about this this way of making the print is that it's always a negative. They're always going to end up swimming in the opposite direction to the way you took the print. So that's pretty cool. There's a flatfish and a sardine. Sometimes the flatfish work really well because you can get a lot of detail out of them. Strangely, with the light coming through this, it can look just as good from the other side.
Love that effect. It's kind of ghostly.
Yeah, so a lot of it becomes quite ghostly. And once they dry as well, they come alive a bit more. This one that was a bit watery earlier now looks really, really impressive, the way that the scales are visible.
And in terms of archiving these artworks afterwards, Stephen, because we've used squid ink, is there kind of a particular way that it needs to be preserved over a period of time?
Yeah, there's a few things you can do. Last time I did the workshop, I mixed the squid ink with a little acrylic medium. I did bring some with me, but I chose not to use it. And that just means that it seals the ink in a little bit more. But really, this will last. You know, squid ink is a really good ink. And I think it was the original ink that people started to use to make drawings centuries and centuries ago. The word sepia is the same name for ink in many languages. And sepia is the name of the cuttlefish. So they, it's chicken and egg. They didn't know which came first, the method or the... So there's another, on the brown paper, that works really well as well.
It's really wonderful. Do you have any recommendations of fish that have kind of scales that will give a really good definition for print?
I mean, most of these have pretty good definition. I would say that looking at them, the scales on the sea bass, is it sea bream? Somebody can tell me. I think I might have got that mixed up now. I think that's a sea bream. Are bigger. The scales on the lemon sole are smaller. But you should be able to get a decent enough impression either way. Sometimes it helps to just take some of the ink off, like to rub it again on the paper before you apply it to the fish. Let it dry a little bit.
Someone has kindly let us know that is sea bream.
Yeah, I realized that halfway through saying it. It is a sea bream. And the bass are a lot more slender. But the reason I chose sea bream is because it's flatter and it has bigger scales as well. So thanks to the ichthyologists out there for their excellent detective skills. Just put this over here for a minute. And you can just wash the ink straight off after you've finished. And it will be fine. In fact, this ink is used in cooking. It's used for
Stephen, it appears that your big screen might have turned off.
Okay.
Your phone screen.
Phone screen, okay.
So for now, if you'd like to continue doing the technique and you can hold up the results to camera, that might be...
How's that?
Brilliant.
I think it's because the battery is running out, so I might have to plug it in.
Great.
Which I think we can do. I think it's close enough to the thing. We'll just pull it up. It's all fun doing these things, isn't it? Whoop. Okay, if you don't mind a little wire coming through in the process, we can get all of this up and running.
And that's the joys of live broadcasting, everyone. Yeah. Thank you for bearing with us.
Not bad.
Wonderful. Steve, we've had another question come through. Can we use the same technique with crabs and lobsters?
You can use the same technique. It's just down to the way the ink adheres. So if you do have a more textured surface, it's likely to give you some better results. But I think crabs and lobsters are knobbly enough to give you a good impression. In fact, I've probably got a crab shell around somewhere that I could run and get, and we could try it out. That might be helpful. Okay, now this is an example of perseverance. So even though it's faint, you'll find that's a pretty good example of Gyotaku. Sometimes you have to wait a while for the ink to get into the scales. And later on, I could probably sit down with a pencil and a cup of tea and make an eye for that. Because one of the things about this process is that the very soft nature of the eyes doesn't give it a great impression. It doesn't make a great impression. Okay, I'm just going to try a couple of these others again, because now that the ink has dried slightly, I wonder if we're going to get different results. And again, this is all trial and error. Letting the ink dry just a little, that might help you with the final result. I'll just give that a little rub as well.
It's really wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that with us today. Just in terms of a time check, everyone, we've got about 5 minutes left, but please feel free to continue the workshops long after we're gone, and we can't wait to see the results.
Okay, so time flies when you're having fun. There's another example. I'm not sure how good that one is, but again, it can just show what one can do if you're experimenting. And that's the key thing to most of these workshops, is they give the participants room to do their own thing. It's not for me to tell anyone how or how not to do things. I can just suggest it. But as if by magic, a scallop shell has appeared, and I'm going to try and do something with that. What I'll do with this is I'll put the paper over the top because it's hard, and then we can just use the roller with a little ink to see if we can get an impression from that. Now, this is very much more like traditional brass rubbing.
Wow, that's absolutely beautiful. It's amazing what you can create with just one technique across so many different objects.
Yeah, and what's really great is we have lots and lots of different attempts. And then later on, when you're done, and you've got 30 pieces of paper around you, you can just go through them all and see which ones you like best. And sometimes the ones you like best are the more abstract ones. Sometimes the ones you like best are the ones with the most detail. And sometimes like the ones you like best are something in between the two. So that's the scallop shell. And you can see that if you just pay attention to all the little crevices, you can end up with something that really starts to appear like the real thing.
We've had some really wonderful feedback today for our workshop, Steve. Someone has said, thank you for your help in answering my questions. You've been brilliant and the workshop is amazing. So thank you.
Oh, good. Well, listen, it's my pleasure. And this kind of thing is always as much of a surprise to me as it is to people taking part, because as I said earlier, it's a really explorative thing, meaning it's really about just finding out things for yourself and how best you prefer to work with the materials at your disposal.
Wonderful. I think we've got time for you to show us maybe one more of these, Steve, today.
Okay, let's go for it. We'll do the big one again. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to rub the whole thing with a roller, just to remind you of the technique, so you can go away and do it whenever you want and then have a delicious meal afterwards. Right, let's plop it down, rub it in, and take it straight off. See what we've got. Wow. That wasn't too bad.
That is absolutely incredible. That's brilliant. Thank you so much for that, Steve. Today's workshop's been really exceptional. And I've learned something today. I'm definitely going to be trying this out at home.
Well, you know what? It doesn't matter what results you get, as long as you've had an enjoyable time. And I've enjoyed myself tremendously. And thanks to everyone at Hospital Rooms. Thanks to everyone who's participated. And thanks for making a mess.
Thank you so much.
There you go. Final one.
Thank you. That's absolutely
best one.
Brilliant. So just, I'd like to just say a huge thank you to Stephen on behalf of Hospital Rooms. And thank you again to everyone that's taken part in the workshop today. Steve, the prints you've created look absolutely amazing. And it's been so wonderful to learn about the origins of this art form and so fun for us all to have a go as well. Thank you to everyone that submitted a question today and let us know where you've been joining us from. It's been fantastic to see so many of you across the country and across the globe, and really exciting for us to see. I'm now going to launch a very quick poll, and it's just for everyone who's joining us to give us a really quick idea of how you found the workshop today. So that should be popping up on your screens now. Great, and that will really help us to improve and develop workshops in future. So thank you to those of you who've answered. We'll give that another 5 seconds or so. Brilliant. That's great. Thank you. That's really brilliant feedback to receive. Thank you, everyone. We're going to end that poll now. Natalie, if you wouldn't mind bringing back our slideshow, that would be great. Thank you. So thank you so much once again to everyone for joining us today. It's been a really fun 45 minutes and the time has absolutely flown by, I'm sure you'll agree. If you're still here with us, I'd just like to share a little bit about Hospital Rooms and how this workshop today has come about. So we're a London-based arts and mental health charity, and we transform inpatient mental health units with contemporary art. We're really thrilled that a lot of the units that we've worked with previously or hope to work with in future have joined us for these sessions today. So we began the digital art school in response to COVID-19, as where we would normally go into units and lead workshops in person. That, of course, was put on hold due to lockdowns. So we decided to launch the art school, and that's given us a really lovely opportunity to bring everyone together and open up art and creating to everyone. So some of the examples that you've just seen in the slideshow are some of the amazing artists that we've worked with so far. We've had the privilege of working with Anish Kapoor, Julian Opie, and of course, wonderful artists such as Stephen Claydon, who led our workshop today. So here at Hospital Rooms, we go into units and we completely transform the spaces. It's really important for us to get everyone involved, and our workshops are such an amazing part of our projects, which is why we're so excited to be able to bring them into the digital space. It's been really important for us to try and build a wonderful community where we can join together in what is, of course, a very difficult time. As you can see on the slide, you can find videos of our past projects and all of our previous digital art school workshops on our YouTube channel, and you can subscribe and watch back at any time. We also have a digital art school mailing list, which keeps you informed of upcoming workshops, materials lists you'll need, along with any relevant downloads and links to last week's video. So you can sign up for that at hospital-rooms.com. You can also share your artworks with us, which we absolutely love to see. And we of course, share with the artists by uploading into our online gallery. So if you've made some prints today in our workshop with Stephen, we'd absolutely love to see them. And you can do that anonymously, or you can let us know your name. So on behalf of Hospital Rooms, I'd like to say a huge thank you to everyone for joining us today for today's workshop. It's been absolutely incredible to see how many of you have joined us. And we'd really love to see you all again next week. Next week, we have the brilliant artist Mark Tickner lead a workshop showing us how to create a ribbon alphabet. And he's worked with us on previous projects within units as well. So from all of us here at Hospital Rooms, I'd like to say thank you so much again for joining us, and we'll see you again next week.